Welcome, foolish mortals, to the Haunted Mansion.
On this week's episode, we're going to be reviewing Six Flags Magic Mountain's Fright Fest. You're listening to episode 140 of the Theme Park Duo podcast.
Prepare yourselves for an unforgettable encounter.
Hi, and welcome to the Theme Park Duo podcast. Grab your park map, Chiro, and hop in line with us as we take you on a coast-to-coast adventure through the world of theme parks, haunts, conventions, and more. Now, here's your hosts, Nikki and Gabriel.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another fantastic episode of the Theme Park Duo podcast. I'm Gabe. I am your host for today. As you see, Nikki is absent, but we have a wonderful guest host in her spot today, a good friend of ours who runs the fantastic website and social media channels, Park Journey. Welcome, Gregg, to the show. Hello, sir.
Hey, Gabe. Thanks for having me on again. Excited to talk about Fright Fest.
You sure sound excited. I'll tell you that. You sound so mellow.
I'm always mellow. You know me. I'm just having my evening drink and enjoying some chat with a friend. Hey,
what is the beverage of choice today? What's the beverage of choice today, then?
I went with a Guinness.
I mean, that's a good choice. It's better than my Diet Coke.
It was funny because I poured my Guinness. I didn't tell anybody I was having a Guinness. And then what did I see on Facebook? A Guinness ad. They're getting really good these ads.
They were like, watching you, dude. They were watching you like a hawk. They were like, oh, we know what this guy wants. We know
they heard that the can open, and they're like, oh, that's a Guinness.
Yeah, pretty much. I can hear that widget at the bottom of it. That's what they're saying.
Exactly, yep. The little CO2 thing in there.
Yeah, it looks like an upside-down creamer what it looks like, is essentially what it is.
Yeah.
But we're not here to talk. Bazzer, shush. My dog likes to shake at inopportune moments during the podcast, as many people who listen to the show would know. But we are not here to talk about Guinness or beer or anything of the sort. We are here to talk about Fright Fest at Six Flags Magic Mountain. Now, Gregg and I actually went together, so we didn't have like two separate experiences or anything. We were literally going through everything together. So we both have these experiences that we want to talk about when it comes to the haunted houses, as the website calls them, and scare zones. And we also did one little extra experience as well. So we're going to be going through everything for you guys so you can get our two cents and thoughts on what Fright Fest has to offer for 2022. We definitely have a lot of thoughts. We definitely have a lot of opinions, like all the time. But let's jump into this thing. So let's start off with the haunted houses. Now, Gregg, you can jump in here and let me know your thoughts. Whenever I think of Fright Fest, I don't particularly think of the haunted houses. They're not in the forefront of my mind when I think about Fright Fest. When I think about Fright Fest, I think the scare zones. So, and I think that's partially because the fact that, you know, the park never closes. It's part of the day ticket. You get the scare zones, and then you have to pay extra for the haunted houses. But for me, the haunted houses are like an extra thing. But I always think about the scare zones.
Yeah, I'm with you. And it hasn't always been that way, to be honest. You know, I've been going to Fright Fest since, you know, the late 90s, probably.
Yeah, fart.
Yeah. I mean, but yeah, you know, the way that it's set up, that the park doesn't close, the monsters all kind of come out at 7, they do kind of an opening moment.
Unleashed, I believe it's called.
Yeah, Unleashed, and DC Universe. They used to do it over by Colossus, but now they do it over in DC Universe. So yeah, it's just, you know, you could go there, and we've done that many times, gone there just to kind of hang out in the scare zones, see a show, you know, whatever, and not done the haunted houses. And, you know, I would say probably once a year we'll go and do the haunted houses, maybe twice. And then, you know, if we end up going, you know, a third time or something like that, it's just for a few hours, just to kind of, you know, to walk around the park and interact with some of the people in the scare zones and, you know, have a, you know, get a drink or have something to eat and then, you know, head home. So, yeah, it's kind of an afterthought.
You make a good point, actually, because, like, unlike any other haunt in SoCal, you don't need to buy a separately purchased, you don't need to purchase separately priced a ticket in order to just enjoy the park during Halloween at nighttime. If you want to go for the coasters during the day and then stay for some of the Halloween festivities, you can. at the price of your regular day ticket, which is pretty nice.
Yeah, you know? I mean, you don't need your frequent fear, your scary farm pass, or you know, whatever it is. Your normal, you know, Six Flags membership or pass gets you into Fright Fest. So that's really kind of what makes it unique, at least in the Southern California market. I know that, you know, other parks in other parts of the country that have, you know, a Cedar Fair park or a Six Flags park, you know, their normal passes are typically good for their Halloween events. You know, Southern California is somewhat unique in that regard, and obviously Orlando as well.
Yeah, very much so. So for people who may not have been to Fright Fest, you know, this is very different compared to many other places. So keep that in mind when, if you're planning on visiting Fright Fest, you don't need to buy an extra ticket, you don't need to know all the stuff, you just need to buy the passes to the haunted houses. But you can come during the day, enjoy those coasters as much as you want, then get all the scares in the once Unleashed happens and all the monsters are let loose in the park, which is pretty cool. But yeah, the haunted houses feel like a little bit of an afterthought to a certain extent. But, I mean, some of them have some pretty cool aspects to them, others not so much.
Yeah,
and I think the...
Go ahead, I'm sorry. I think that's why, you know, you have at Magic Mountain, you have, you know, haunted houses that have been there for, you know, in the case of Willoughby's, you know, it's been a part of, you know, Fright Fest for probably 20 years now.
I don't know Fright Fest without it.
Yeah. I mean, there's been, you know, at least two, you know, there's the original Willoughby's Haunted Mansion, and there's Willoughby's Resurrected. And then it's been, you know, modified a couple of times, you know, throughout the years. I mean, I remember the first year when they revamped Willoughby's, you know, I got a tour with Neil, who's now the park president of Busch Gardens Tampa, you know, showing off their, you know, their renovated maze. And that was, my son was... It was like maybe 10 years ago, and now my son, probably even more than that. And now my son lives in Canada and is getting married. So that just, you know, there's pictures of him and Neil, you know, and he's like, you know, a preteen or, you know, barely a teenager.
Yeah.
And, you know, on a tour of this haunted house when they renovated Willoughby's the first time.
So essentially what Willoughby's is like, it's RoboCop essentially. So, you know, the original version, you start off as a human, and then we get to now, you're mostly robot. That's exactly what it's like.
I mean, it was a walkthrough back in the 80s before it was even a haunted house. You know, it was, you know, it was the Magic Pagoda, for those of you that go way back in Magic Mountain. So, it, you know, it really has, honestly, the actual walkthrough of it hasn't really changed since the Magic Pagoda days. It's the same path as it's always been. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Nothing's changed?
The actual path itself is pretty much, if from what I remember, I mean, I was a kid, but from what I remember of the Magic Pagoda, the actual path that you traverse through the haunted house is pretty much the same as it was for the Magic Pagoda.
Interesting. You're filled with facts for Six Flags that I would never know, because I don't know Magic Mountain as well as you do, so I always find that kind of stuff very fascinating to hear. But let's jump into this first maze. Now, this is the newest maze. It's called Truth or Dare. And we didn't actually get to experience this. Now, when we went to Fright Fest, the maze hadn't opened yet. They were, I think, when we went, it was their second weekend. And I think they opened this up on their third or fourth weekend?
The third weekend, yeah. This past weekend. Yeah, this past weekend.
So the synopsis for this one is, in a warped game of truth or dare, the unknown lurking in the shadows will leave you questioning your every move. Now, when they announced this, I very much told Nikki, I was like, I don't know how they're going to kind of develop this into a haunted house. How do you turn truth or dare into a haunted house? So we did watch a YouTube video because we didn't get to go through it. We watched a YouTube video, a better quality YouTube video of that, to kind of see what it was about. And I part of me feels like they don't know either.
Yeah.
There is a concept to it. Like, there is a concept to it. But after the main entry room, kind of lose it.
You know, they're kind of going for like a, you know, I'm like, okay, they're kind of going for a TV studio type of thing. And you're behind the scenes of the TV studio. But there's just no, you know, it doesn't even look like an office. You know, if they were like, okay, this is behind the scenes at a TV studio. Well, if you've ever been in a TV studio, behind the scenes is just basically like any other office that you're going to ever
see.
Pretty much. And it doesn't even look like that. You know, there's a couple, you know, scenes where they have like some lockers or something maybe. But, you know, it would have been better off if they had just like duplicated Dunder Mifflin and like there's your office and you're walking through these TV studios. It just seems there was just black walls pretty much everywhere. I'm hoping that it's, you know, the video, maybe they're not as black as, you know, as it seems. I'm hoping to get up there, hopefully, you know, this weekend and check it out. But yeah, it just seemed very, very plain compared to, you know, what was there before, which was Red's Revenge, which, you know, was highly themed.
Yeah. And the thing is that like the entrance and the facade, everything is very well themed, and especially to the concept and how they want to execute it. You know, it's basically a giant TV that you're walking into. So once you walk through that TV, you enter like a little room where you get a very, very quick video synopsis of what it is. It's a game show, Truth or Dare, and basically it's like a killer version of it. But like you said, after you leave that room,
there's not much there. Yeah.
Pretty much non-existent.
Yeah.
There are some interesting scares, but overall they're still doing the stuff that Six Flags does a lot of, where it's like, get out, hurry, right, run, boo. Leave.
Yeah.
A lot of yelling.
Yeah.
So I don't know what happened. Like, I don't know, because like you said, you had Red's Revenge there before. That was, you know, albeit long to the tooth, it still had great set design.
It
had good set design.
Yeah.
And now we have this.
Yeah. From what I understand, that they only kind of reached out to the group that did this like 3 months ago. So, you know, that's kind of what you get.
I feel like for 3 months, you could at least put other sets in there.
Yeah. You know, and I really do think the concept has merit. And I do hope that in future years, they don't just leave it the way that it is right now for the next, you know, 8 to 10 years that the maze is going to be there. That they do kind of take the next year and add to it. Because I don't think it's a bad concept. I think that, you know, and I think as far as like the execution, like you said, with the facade and the pre-show and the first room, I think that I was like, oh, this actually looks kind of cool. And then once you go into like the second or third room, it's like, oh. And that was pretty much it. So, yeah, I'm hoping that, you know, maybe they just kind of ran out of time and they wanted to get the attraction open, which part of me understands it. Part of me would have been like, you know what, let's just go ahead and say we're not going to have a new maze this year and do it right next year. But I'm hoping that they'll actually add to it here for you know, Fright Fest 2023, and we'll get kind of a plused, you know, version of what we have now.
Yeah, and part of me really feels like they would have been better off not opening it with how minimal it is, because there's, at a certain point, there's a detriment to the product of Fright Fest, and as well as like the general public's idea and thoughts about Fright Fest when you put a product out like this. Because we both know, you and I both know, that we've seen what Fright Fest is capable of in terms of developing a product that is excellent.
Absolutely.
And it's disappointing when you get something like this, knowing what they're capable of. So I feel like it's a little bit of a detriment to the event itself when you open something up that feels unfinished, unpolished, and really just not ready.
Yeah, I
wish they just never opened it.
Yeah,
I wish they never opened it.
Yeah, I'm fully in agreement with you there. I just like I said, I just wish that they would have just said, you know what, it's not quite ready. You know, this goes beyond Six Flags. This goes for pretty much, you know, any park. You know, just be honest with your customer. Be like, you know what, hey, it's not ready. You know, we're either still working on it for the rest of the season, or we're just going to go ahead and debut it, and we're going to do it right. And we're going to debut it next year. And then just, you know, say, here's, you know, all the people that we're going to work in that maze or that haunted house. We're going to put in other haunted houses. We're going to have more people in, you know, Willoughby's or Vault, or we're going to put more people in the scare zones. So that those, you know, those scare actors that were there, they're going to kind of move somewhere else this year, and then we'll just do it right next year. I wish they would have just done that.
There is a certain level of respect that I have for a park when they are able to be honest with their audience and their guests who are attending an event. You know, if Six Flags had come out and been like, yeah, we're just not ready. You know, next year we're going to have this brand new maze ready to go for you guys. We just weren't ready to go this time around. I would have been fine with it. I would have been totally fine with it. And I have a lot of respect for people who are able to do that. And unfortunately, I think there's just a conundrum of like, well, the backlash of us saying there's a new maze and now there's not, you know, people who are buying tickets for the new maze and now we don't have it, I feel like there's that battle between wanting to do right and wanting to make sure that people who bought tickets are appeased. But I feel like in this case, nobody really wins.
Agreed. Agreed 100%.
So, thankfully, I feel like Truth or Dare is probably the lowest haunted house on the totem pole here, so to speak. I feel like it's the worst out of all of them, so we're really only going up from here. I do have to say, though, that this year I had a lot more fun in the haunted houses than I have in prior years. So I'm excited to talk about the rest of them because there are redeeming factors to a lot of what they're doing. And I think you and I both have some fun ideas on how they could probably excel it even more. And I think that kind of comes down to this next one too, which is Willoughby's Resurrected, which for all intents and purposes is like the center stage haunted house for this event.
100%.
This is the one. This is the one that's been around for the longest, the one that gets the most love, the one that gets a ton of actors. You know, this is the one that's held up on a pedestal for Fright Fest, in my opinion. And rightfully so.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, like we've talked about, you know, earlier, you know, this haunted house has been around for, you know, probably 20 years, maybe even more than that now. So it's a Six Flags Magic Mountain icon. I mean, they've developed, you know, an entire family around this maze and characters that are beloved. At Fright Fest, both in and out of the maze or haunted house, that you know, kind of are part of the Willoughby's family. So it, you know, it's kind of you know, this one, you know, for the most part, I'm not a big fan of how long Six Flags keeps the mazes or haunted houses around, but this one I kind of give a pass to just because
the history.
It's not that, and it's like their icon. You know, you have you know, at Universal Orlando, they have their different icons and everything. And Willoughby's is kind of Six Flags icon. You know,
even as though far it's a house,
right?
Even though it's a house, it's still for it's, us that yeah, kind of
it's their icon.
What we hold it up to,
or it's like the Green Witch at Knott's. It's, you know, it's just one of those things that's like it's a mainstay at Fright Fest, and it would feel almost kind of weird if it wasn't there in some regard. Now, that's not to say that they need to just keep it the same for, you know, forever. And, you know, they did plus it a little bit this year, which was nice to see.
There were some really cool effects that they did. They actually added a lot of visual effects with characters that audiences and fans of Fright Fest would know from the Scare Zone. You know, you have, like you mentioned, the family of the Willoughbys as characters, but one of the most prominent ones being Innocence. Who everybody knows who Innocence is, who they go to Fright Fest and you're fans of the event. And she's in the house now, which makes plenty of sense. I would love to see more of that, because there was a couple really good effects that they had her involved in. And I want to see that expanded upon. I want more of that, more of the involvement of those iconic characters that we know about with the Willoughbys.
Absolutely. And, you know, there was, you know, small touches that, you know, most people probably wouldn't notice. There was, you know, kind of new tapestries in a couple different spots, and some of the video effects went from just generic things that you could find, you know, on, you know, at any store that, you know, they could tell they were kind of done in house. Yeah, exactly. So they updated some of that stuff. Like you said, the Innocence, some of the kind of lighting and almost, you know, projection mapping in a couple of the scenes was definitely updated as well. And the lighting at Fright Fest, as far as I'm concerned, is some of the best at any event anyway. They have a really great lighting designer up there. And but yeah, just a lot of, you know, little things that, again, I don't think a lot of people would notice if they weren't nerds like us.
Yeah,
but you know, walking through, enough. I was like, "Oh, that's new. Oh, that's new. Okay, that's cool." You know, type of thing. So, you know, kudos to them for, you know, not just keeping it the same and adding some new little touches to the haunted house.
And I definitely would dare to say that Willoughby's is probably the scariest of all the haunted houses. Granted, I'm dead inside. Nothing really truly scares me at this point. You know, you really have to get me good in order for something to get me. But I feel like the way Willoughby's is designed, the layout, the sets, you know, sometimes the absence of music can kind of really set a tone that is really creepy. It really puts you on edge. And I like that. I think that's fantastic. If anything, I want to see them lean into that even more. And that was something you and I discussed as we were leaving the haunted house. It was like, this needs to be the creepy, moody, you know, gothic haunted house, not the boo scare haunted house.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I will say that, you know, that is probably the one drawback on this one. And you know, many of the mazes at Fright Fest is they go for the boo scare. And like you said, you know, Willoughby's Haunted Mansion, at, you know, her, you know, Willoughby's Resurrected, it's a haunted house. You don't need, you know, the boo scare. Like, there were some really amazing, creepy characters with some really good lines, some really good scenes. And then at the end, they're just like screaming in your ear. And it's like, well, you didn't need to do that. Like, you were way creepier without the boo at the end. And I know that's because that's how they're trained. And for some mazes, it works. For some haunted houses, it works. It doesn't really work for Willoughby's. And I, like you said, I think they, you know, would be better served to just kind of keep it, you know, keep it the creepy haunted house type thing.
I mean, I'm not going to lie, Gregg. I don't think that screaming the way that they're screaming fits in any haunted house. I personally don't think it does fit ever. It's just not something that should be done. And I know that Nikki and I have talked about that for a lot of times. You know, we've mentioned it in our reviews. The screaming as loud as they can in someone's face, that's not scary. It's not scary to anybody. Like, it's yeah, just not. No, it just hurts your ears.
I'm with you. I just, you know, I don't know if there's a place for it, but there's definitely places where it's more appropriate than Willoughby's, as far as I'm concerned. But no, I'm with you. I'm not a huge fan of the boo.
If you're going to scream, just don't do it right next to my ear, because that's not scary. It just hurts.
Right.
It just hurts. And if I want to be hurt, I'll do it somewhere where I have a safe word, not in a haunted house. So just want to put that out there, that maybe no one's screaming in people's ears, because I think that this haunted house has so much friggin' potential. Like, it has a lot of potential. And if anything, it's probably one of the best at the event. I just want to see it plus to the point where it is becomes a contender for people's favorite haunted house out of any event.
Yeah, no, totally. We're in agreement here.
Yeah. So moving on from Willoughby's Resurrected, which I didn't read that synopsis. Sorry there. Let me read that. The Willoughby's family mansion tale unfolds before your eyes at this once affluent Victorian mansion that has become a haven for evil spirits, presented by Snickers. That was the synopsis for Willoughby's. And the next one up on our list here is Vault 666 Unlocked. Demonic relics and obsolete oddities? I think they were just going for alliteration. Are locked in an abandoned vault in this dark and sinister antique shop, presented by Three Musketeers. So, by the way, I've always said that whenever they say presented by a particular candy, they need to give you the candy as you leave the haunted house. I never know why they haven't done that.
100%.
So Vault 666 Unlocked, this was one in the past where I was not a huge fan of it. They did, I think it was called, what was that horror movie where they said they were doing it in this space, Fright Nights or something?
It was, oh god, I don't even remember seeing it. What was that? It was some horror movie that was at like a, you know, like a theme park,
a Halloween carnival.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I don't remember.
Well, anyway, they were supposed to have that in this haunted house. It was supposed to be the movie maze, and nothing changed. Literally nothing was changed. Maybe you had a couple things.
They had a sign.
A couple actors with the new masks.
Yeah, I think that there was a sign, and there was maybe a couple of like prop boxes that had the name of the movie on it that year, but that was about it.
Yeah, so, you know, I left with a bad taste in my mouth. So even before going in, I remember telling you, like, this is one of my least favorite. I just want to get it over with. Because I was just in there to take photos, but I left very surprised at how much fun I had. There were some very fun sight gags in this house that I loved enough to want to go through it again. There were some really fun moments.
Yeah, I think we did a few of the houses. You know, this was one that we did twice, along with Willoughby's, I think, that we did twice as well. And, you know, it's funny to think back, the first year they did Vault, it was kind of like a... you know, you're doing experiments on animals and you're mashing up these different animals. And
which I dug. I thought that was cool.
But now it's completely, you know, that is not a part of it at all. You know, I mean, honestly, this is still a fun one. Again, this was, I think the location where it was used to be a, It was an arcade and I think a storage room too. So they have, you know, it's been the same location for a while. There's nothing really new with, you know, the layout hasn't changed, but they put in some new, you know, there's like a black light scene, and there was a room that was kind of like a bloodletting room that they've kind of redone. It's not as gory, so to speak. Yeah. So yeah, like you said, this was a fun one. There's still, there was a couple of rooms that were different. There was like a doll room now. It seems kind of like almost like a mishmash of different things now, but
the greatest hits of haunted houses.
Which I mean, it's not a terrible thing. And you know, you said, you know, the description now is, you know, you're going into like an oddity shop, and you know, so yeah, if you're going to an oddity shop, you're going to see a lot of different, really weird, random things. And that's kind of what this maze is. So I guess it works.
What's funny is that a couple of the things that you mentioned were that room with the dolls. So basically, for people who are listening, just to kind of give you a sense of this, you walk into this room, you're not in it long. It's pretty small, actually. So there's dolls kind of situated everywhere, mannequins situated everywhere. Everything's dressed up in Victorian-style dresses. And all of the faces of the mannequins and dolls have these doilies covering their eyes so they can't see, and it's just very odd and it's very creepy. It gives it off a very weird vibe. You know, it's not meant to be that, you know, boo scary moment. It's supposed to set a tone, and I think it works really, really well. And even the scene after that, it's more like a blackout room with a whole bunch of cloaked characters wearing these very almost demonic-esque masks, and you don't know which one's the real person. I think both those rooms are executed exceptionally well. In fact, I actually think that those two rooms would do really, really, really well in Willoughby's. Like, if you take those two scenes out and put them in Willoughby's and kind of change the theme of Willoughby's a little bit to help fit those two additions, I think that would be awesome in Willoughby's.
You know, it's funny because I started noticing last year, I think it was last year, maybe 2019, that there was some scenes that in different mazes, I'm like, well, that seems like it should be in Willoughby's, or that seems like it should be here, kind of. Maybe it was originally designed for, you know, a different maze, but then they decided to, oh, let's put it in here because it's kind of a mishmash type of maze now. So, yeah, I can totally see that with those two particular rooms.
Yeah, but overall, I mean, it was a lot of fun. I think the one visual that kind of stuck with me, I was turning a corner, and there was a person pressing themselves up against this fabric wall. So all you see is, like, this half-human body coming out of the wall, essentially. Very Nightmare on Elm Street-esque feeling to it, and as soon as you get close to it, they back away from it. And just visually, that was so fun and so creepy, and I dug it. I just left with a big smile on my face because it was just silly, good, scary fun. And yeah, that's all it really comes down to.
Yeah, because I remember, you know, like you said, you weren't really looking forward to, you know, you were like, you know, salt, you know, whatever.
I was very hesitant. I was very hesitant.
And then we went through again, you know, we went through it, and you're like, well, we got to do that again. That was really fun. And we did. And it was really fun. Even the second time. Yeah, no.
And the thing is that, like, I feel like a lot of people tend to say, you know, we need a story, we need a cohesive A, B, C, D, E, F, G. I don't think that's the case all the time. Sometimes, why can't we just have a fun, spooky, scary mashup of stuff? And that's kind of what this feels like in the best way possible. Like, I mean that with the utmost respect. Like, it's fantastic. Like, I enjoyed it so much.
Yeah, and I have no problem with them, you know, reusing stuff from previous mazes or scare zones and things like that. You know, make a mishmash maze. Like, here's a room for this maze, and here's a room for that maze. I'm actually all for it. We actually talked about that a little bit on, I think it was Thursday. We were at Scary Farm, kind of, you know, talking about, you know, mazes that have like one room from like different mazes, and I'm cool with that. And that's what Vault kind of feels like.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Moving on from Vault, we have Condemned Forever Damned, which sits literally right across the way almost from Vault 666 Unlocked. And the synopsis for this one is, beware the souls of those who lived in this dilapidated home, presented by Twix. So this one, I remember really liking when it came out for the first year that they had it. I think it was
2018, somewhere around there, maybe even 16.
I remember liking it a lot. I thought that the set designs were super fun. I thought that they definitely excelled and took a next step forward in the evolution of Fright Fest haunted houses. This year I feel a bit differently, just because I don't feel like much has changed about it, and the only thing that I would say has changed is the lighting. And it's just very dark. Like, it was very hard to tell what was happening at times.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest. I've never been a huge fan of this one, to be honest with you.
Oh, really? No. I liked it the first time around. It felt very like a Hoarders-esque, you know, weird kind of stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, there were some cool effects, like the first year with the TV and, you know, kind of, you know, different things.
Yeah.
It's a very short maze. I think for some reason it just feels particularly short. And even my walkthrough, I think it was like 2.5 minutes long to get through the whole thing. And, you know, we were taking our time. But, yeah, I've never been a huge, huge fan of this. But like you said, I don't think anything has really changed in here other than, you know, like you said, it's gotten darker. Trying to, you know, get video on our new fancy, you know, iPhone 13 and your 14, you know, it's so dark, you know, and you can usually, you know, tell some things in mazes. And the other thing is, I don't think there was a whole lot of monsters in here either.
I would say probably 3 or 4.
Yeah. Total. So, yeah, I mean, I understand the concept. I get where they're going. I wish that they would, you know, there's another former maze sitting right next to it that they used to use, which was, you know, the toys of terror. Yeah. So, you know, if you want to keep this concept, that's great. Move into that building, make the maze even longer, and then, you know, maybe open it up a little bit. They're going for a very claustrophobic, you know, deserted house type thing. And I get it. It's just not one that's been, you know, huge on my list, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it kind of went down on my list a bit from when I originally had gone through it. So it's kind of unfortunate because I do think the concept works. It's just, I don't feel like it's being executed to the highest of its abilities, so a little bit sad on that part. Then we're moving on to Sewer of Souls. Vanish into an underground world of lost souls and terrifying tunnels where evil oozes and creatures taunt, presented by M&M's. Now, this was the haunted house that gives you the 3D glasses because it's chroma depth paint. And if you've never heard of chroma depth, it's basically just like a cheap way of doing 3D with the paper 3D glasses. And it just makes the depth play happen a lot more.
I think this is the only 3D maze left, right, in Southern California?
Yeah, it's the only one.
Yeah, there was one in Chino last year that was, I don't know if they're coming back this year, but yeah, I think that this is the only 3D maze, at least at the major events. Which, you know, it's fun. I really like this one. It's creepy. The characters in it are really unique. I like the chroma depth. I think we did it once with the glasses and one without, just to kind of get both experiences. Yeah. It's just fun. There's some fun set pieces in here. There's, you know, like the you walk across the bridge, and then there's a couple of the little blow up things you walk through. And I think this one, as far as like the sets are concerned, I think it has some really, really, really fun stuff. And I think the talent and the monsters in here kind of they have fun with it. You can tell. So this one is not really a scary one. It's a fun.
It's kind of goofy.
Yeah,
it's a bit goofy. Like, it knows what it's doing, which is good. It kind of just never really hits the right note for me whenever I go through it. I know what they're going for. I get what they're trying. It just never works. I do agree with you that I think the talent was definitely on. You know, even though something doesn't scare me or doesn't really work for me, I'm still capable of understanding what talent is definitely on their marks.
I think you make a good point on this one. Out of all of the Fright Fest mazes, I think this is the one that knows what it is the most.
It has the most attitude, and it has the most buttoned up tone.
Yeah, because like you know Vault, like you said, is just kind of a mishmash of different things. Condemned is kind of this claustrophobic house. Willoughby's is, you know, it has people from Scare Zone and has, you know, all the classic, you know, Fright Fest. But this one is, it's straight up, it's a sewer, and it's got souls in it. Like, it's, yeah, you know, it's not a high concept maze, which is fine. Not, I have no problem with that. It doesn't need to be.
Doesn't ever
exactly
have to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like this one, I feel like there's a lot of really fun gags. Like you mentioned the bridge. So for people who haven't been in this haunted house, essentially you walk through like this little passageway, and there's this very cool illusion where it looks like you're on a very small plank of wood walking over a pit of water that's really, really deep. And they're basically using mirrors to accomplish this illusion. And it's really smart, because I remember the first time I saw it, it threw me off, and it actually made me nervous for a hot second, because I wasn't quite sure what I was standing over. Now that I know how it's done, it's 10 times cooler.
Right.
I really like that effect, and, you know, like you mentioned, the airbags, you know, everyone's kind of gone through those birthing canals, if you will, inside of a haunted house. And this one kind of angles upwards, so it gets higher and higher. And underneath, they have the compressed air kind of hitting your legs, so it makes you feel like there's something touching you. There's a lot of fun gimmicky gags in here that are a ton of fun that kind of just are meant to gross you out.
Yeah, this is just a fun classic type haunted house. I mean,
I have no qualms about that. Not my favorite.
No,
but at least it knows what it is.
It knows what it is, and I'm okay with it.
Yeah. And the last one on our list here is Aftermath 2 Chaos Rising. The city of Ash Valley is threatened with the release of a deadly poison presented by Milky Way. Now, that's very vague. It's so funny. Like, I always just assumed it was zombies, but that's very, very vague. And I'm still waiting for Aftermath 3, 4, and 5 after Aftermath 2 Chaos Rising.
Yeah.
I feel like there should have been a 3, 4, and 5 and adjustments to this. Because along with Willoughby's, I feel like Aftermath is one of those bases that can easily be a headlining house for the event. It's like, hey, we have our classic characters that we've had around for a long time at Willoughby's, and come check out the largest outdoor haunted house in Southern California, and update it and change it and incorporate a lot of fun aspects to it, so you're not just leaning back on the big open space.
Yeah,
as an appeal.
Yeah, I mean, this one almost feels more like a scare zone more than anything, and you're just kind of walking through it. You know, this was a haunted house, you know, back before they built Justice League in the old Batman theater. That was where, you know, Aftermath first started, and it was, you know, a large outdoor maze, but it wasn't quite as spread out as you know, Aftermath 2 is. You know, but most of the maze is basically just people yelling at you that, you know, there's a virus and you need to get out. And that's not scary.
It really is. And honestly, like, it's disappointing, because in past years, they put in a lot of money and effort making sure that the infected or the monsters that are involved in whatever's happening look like monsters. And they bought some immortal masks. They brought a lot of stuff. Put stilt walkers in. There was a lot of really great additions that I was wild over. Yeah. And I was excited to see what the changes were going to be moving forward. Little did I know the changes were going to be removing all of it.
Yeah, basically. You know?
And now it's just people with black and white makeup acting like zombies. And
it's not really even zombies, though. It's, you know, I got the scare in this maze, 2016. They did me up. You know, obviously they didn't just put regular black and white makeup on. They spent like an hour and a half like doing me up, and which was awesome. Don't get me wrong. And I would do it again in a heartbeat. But you know, since then, you know, like you said, the maze has really changed. And I know we're going to get into scare zones here in a minute, but you know, they've added a new, scare zone outside of Aftermath, which is the Dead Zone. And it's kind of like, you know, neon zombie type thing, which I actually think is really cool. I would love it if they would just expand that into the maze, like make the Dead Zone Aftermath, like put in all those neon 3D, not 3D, but neon lights and the zombies, get rid of the soldiers yelling at you to go through the maze. We don't need it. We know the path. Just, you know, keep some of the cool, like keep the fire effect, keep some of the really cool stuff in there, and then just kind of bring that Dead Zone theme into that maze. And I think it would actually breathe entirely new light in, and you would get your Aftermath 3, the Dead Zone.
Dude, there you go. You just literally just thought about Aftermath 3, the Dead Zone. That works out so perfectly.
It works, right?
It writes itself. It writes itself. If anything, the thing that caused the containment issue in the first place is neon green.
Right. And I mean, let's be honest here. In a post-pandemic world, do we really need a maze kind of going through an outbreak? I'm kind of done with it. You know, like I remember like the early days of COVID, we watched Outbreak just because we were like, let's watch Outbreak. No,
it's too real.
It was too real. You know, it, like I said, it's fun, and I do think that, you know, the town that is in there, they try, but I think more than any other maze at Fright Fest, this one is in need of a retheme. Again, I'm not saying abandon it completely. I think that it's a great concept. I think that some of the scenes in there and some of the buildings, and there's some classic stuff that, you know, there's the old Thomas and Martha Wayne statue from, you know, Gotham City backlot that's in there, which is really cool to see. You know, there's some of the buildings in there that were from the Batman stunt show still in there. And it's got great stuff. Just, you know, I think it just needs, you know, needs that push to upgrade it and make it and bring it back. You know, the first Aftermath, it was beloved. I remember the last year that they had it, they let me go in and take pictures on the very last night of it, and the lines were, you know, huge, and everyone wanted to say goodbye to Aftermath. And when Aftermath 2 started, you know, it was very popular. There was nobody in line when we went. We had in front of the line, and I don't think we really needed it all night. So, you know, it's just, I mean, we went on a Sunday, you know, I just think that this one, out of all of them, like I said, I think this one, I would love it to see just a complete redo of the story of this maze. Maybe not all new sets, but the story, and then, like I said, bring in that dead zone, you know, brightness and fun, I think would be really, really awesome.
Also, double, triple the amount of monsters you're having in there. If you're going to be claiming one of the largest haunted houses, you need to have the right amount of people to fit that footprint. You 100%. Can't just have 3, 4, 5 monsters.
Yeah.
Because it just feels like a lot of hallways. And when, like, half those monsters are yelling at you.
Yeah. Yeah.
It just doesn't work. So yeah. You need to really populate that house to make sure it feels right.
Going back to the truth or dare thing, they should have just, you know, said, we're doing this next year. All those truth or dare people, put them in Aftermath.
Yeah, seriously. That or we'll get to it at some point, but City Under Siege. You know, put them over at City Under Siege or something. I don't know. Whatever would work. But yeah, just having the right amount of staff needs to be a priority across the board. But yeah, that brings us to the end of the haunted houses. That was all of them. I'd say out of all of them, Willoughby's is probably going to be my favorite.
Yeah, I agree.
Just because it's such a classic. There's a lot of really fun sight visual gags, a lot of moments for good scares, incorporating the park characters into the haunted house, all of the above. I think that it's the one that people should go check out if you're going to go into a haunted house at Fright Fest.
100%.
So, moving on, let's talk about something that we actually haven't talked about yet. Something that we got to do before we went to any of the haunted houses, which is the brand new monstertainment thing that they're doing at Fright Fest, which is called Spirits with Spirits, and it is a happy haunting hour with spirits of both natures and devilish treats to die for, and it's a buffet with one drink included, and it is from 6 to 9 p.m., and it is located at the West Picnic Pavilion, and I believe it's about $60. Now, this is an all-you-can-eat buffet. You can come back anytime you want between 6 and 9, which is pretty fantastic. We got to do this, and it was odd because there was only one monster. So it was more
Spirit
with spirits.
Yeah.
Spirits with spirit, or vice versa. And he didn't really interact with us too much. So I feel like if there were more people there than just us, I feel like that level of energy and interaction would increase.
I agree. It was interesting. Like you said, there was only us. I think there was maybe 4 other people. You know, throughout, you know, kind of, we were there for probably what, half an hour, 45 minutes, and there was 2 other people when we got there, and then there was 2 other people when we left. So yeah, it was not very busy. The food was, you know, the food was buff. You know, if you've ever done an event at Six Flags Magic Mountain, it's the food that you would get at any event. You know, they had the chicken wings and pudding and, you know, all that stuff, and pulled pork and sausages and hot dogs, and then you got your free drink. But I think, you know, and I kind of mentioned this in my review, and I think the issue that I had is there's no inherent advantage
yeah,
of doing this. You know, at other events, you get, you know, early entry to a couple of the mazes. Maybe you get a front of the line pass to, you know, a maze or an attraction. Like you said, the concept of being able to go, you know, for 3 hours and go back and eat more, that's great. But the Western Picnic Pavilion at Magic Mountain is by where the lockers are in the front of the park. So if you're back at Aftermath trying to get back to the front to get more
food, there's no way it's going to happen. This
it's
is not. Just,
it's not something that's going to happen. Like you said, there are a couple of other picnickers I think might have been a little bit more centrally located, or they used to use the restaurant up on Samurai Summit for their pre-scare dinner. So I think that would have probably been a better option as well. I think that, you know, maybe 40 would have been a better price point versus the $59.
$40 would have definitely been a bit more, been able to stomach it a bit more. And also maybe including some type of like Fright Fest refillable drink for the night.
Yeah.
You know, so that, you know, if you don't want to get food, you don't want to make it all the way back to the front of the park, you can refill your drink at Katie's Kettle or something. Right.
Here's a coupon for a dessert, you know, before, you know, or a funnel cake before you leave.
You
know, I mean, because, you know, you think about it, you know, we did the buffet at Scary Farm on Friday, and that was $50. You know, it's got the Knott's buffet. We got, you know, our all night drink bottles, which is, you know, $15 right there. And then you get, you know, the four back mazes, you know, before the park even opens.
30 minutes before the
park. Yeah, 30. Yeah. And then you get, you know, Ghost Rider, you know, you can go on Ghost Rider, you know, whatever. So, you know, I think that it's a great concept, and I hope that they do kind of stick with it and just tweak it, because I think that that's something that they should have. I just think that, you know, it's something that, hey, we're going to give you a maze pass, you know, along with it.
Yeah, just one. It doesn't need to be anything crazy. Just one maze pass or one ride pass, like, or you get to choose one of the two.
Or it includes, you know, the standard, you know, the upcharge to get, you know, to go in the regular line for the mazes. I mean, that's, you know, because you figure if you're doing the Spirits with Spirit, that's 60. You want to do the maze pass, that's another 20. You know, kind of just combine the two and you know, do that. I think they would have definitely had more people, you know, wanting to go and do that.
Yeah, 100%. And, you know, I think one of the highlights, at least for me, when it came to Spirits of Spirits, was the signature cocktails that they had. I actually thought that was a highlight. Great. They give you this cool Six Flags Fright Fest glass, plastic, of course, with a signature drink. So, like, basically, you know, you're given that drink voucher when you come in. You can easily get, like, a beer or cider or something, or get one of these signature cocktails. Now, I have them in front of me. They're all named after something from the park for Fright Fest. So the first drink is Vault 666 Unlocked, and that's vodka, cranberry, lemon juice, and grenadine. Then there's Willoughby's Resurrected, which is tequila, orange juice, and grenadine. Sewer of Souls, tequila, sour apple liqueur, lime juice, Sprite, and lime wedge. Aftermath 2, which is Jack and Coke with a splash of grenadine. Condemned Forever Damned is Blue Carousel, vodka, lemonade, and edible glitter. Then they have Truth or Dare, which is either citrus or blue or berry vodka jello shots. And then there's Vampire Fuel, which is sangria and blood bag. And then, of course, for people who don't drink, they do have mocktails, which are the Werewolf's Fane, which is Sprite and strawberry syrup, Monster Street, which is Coke and strawberry syrup, and Witch's Brew, which is Sprite with blueberry syrup and edible glitter. So they did have some cool drinks. I don't remember what you got, but I'm almost certain that what I got was the It was the Vault 666.
Yeah, I got the Sewer of Souls, which was good.
Yeah,
yeah.
And what I found cute was that she asked me, "Do you want an eyeball or a gummy worm?" And I was like, "I want to take an eyeball."
Yeah,
and it ended up being cool. A little lychee with a blueberry in the middle to make it look like an eyeball.
It was kind of cool. Like, you know, it was a cool environment. They had some photo ops there, and they had a thing where you could put, you know, spin the phone around and get, you know, like a 360 video thing. I think we both did it. They had some, you know, kind of skeletons coming out of graves type thing, and you know, so I mean, it wasn't, you know, again, it wasn't a total I don't think it's, you know, it's not the worst thing. I just think that they need to kind of adjust it a little bit. You know, they need to adjust the price point a little bit, and they need to give a little bit more of an incentive to kind of get people, you know, especially if you're bringing something back the first year after not having a kind of a pre pre-food, you know, pre-scare type thing for a few years. You know, you need to give some people, you know, you need to give people an incentive to check it out. And I think, you know, giving everybody here's a exit pass to Wonder Woman, or here's an exit pass to Willoughby's, or whatever it is. You know, I think that would go a really long way to kind of letting people, making people want to actually go. One thing I will mention too, somebody else had mentioned on Twitter, you know, was they didn't have a whole lot of vegetarian options at this. So I think that's also something that they maybe want to take note of as well, because I had somebody that wanted to go and they're vegetarian, and I was like, there's, you know, salad and the corn. I think that was pretty much about it. So, you know, maybe some other, you know, vegetarian options would have, you know, gotten a few more people in there as well.
And I think there was a woman in there that we met, she said she was gluten-free, and sometimes that's very difficult for her to eat. So I think she said she was able to find a few things here, which was nice. But, you know, being able to open up that food offerings, like you said, Gregg, to encompass different dietary needs, which would be fantastic. So after that, let's jump into the scare zones. This is going to kind of be the last thing we're going to be talking about tonight. Other than our main thoughts of the entirety of the event. But for me, these scare zones are like where Fright Fest lives and breathes. Like, this 100%. Is the thing.
Yeah.
When I come to Fright Fest, this is where I'm coming. This is why I'm coming. I want the special interactions with characters. I want those unique experiences. And the thing is that the talent here is so damn good. And they're able to give people unique experiences that they're not going to get anywhere else. You know, these actors are given such free rein to take ownership over these characters that they've pretty much come to know and love.
Yeah, and they've played a part in creating. Yeah, I mean, and they played a part in creating them. And, you know, more than any other event that I've been to, maybe the only one that might have come close would have been Dark Harbor, where the scare actors and scare zones just have the free, like you said, have the freedom to have a storyline, have interactions with you. You know, they all have, you know, a lot of them have, you know, their own Instagrams, and they share kind of their stories and on social media, and they're just, you know, they're not static characters, you know, just walking around, you know, sliding and scaring people, which don't get me wrong, that's great. But yeah, these characters all have backstories, and every year they expand on them. There's characters that have been around for, you know, years and years and years, and every year they've like, oh, this is what I was up to, you know, it's like in their character. Here's my new thing that's going on. And people, that's what brings people back to Fright Fest. Those are the interactions and the characters and the things that keep bringing me and you and a lot of other people back to Fright Fest year after year.
Yeah, and I feel like I hear a lot of people yelling like right now, like, hey, what about Knott's Berry Farm? They have the Bride, Gecko and Otis. You know, they have a lot of these iconic characters that are known to be at Scary Farm. And while, yes, it is similar in that sense that you go to Fright Fest, you're going to see the characters that you know and love. Same thing with Knott's Berry Farm, or Knott's Scary Farm, rather. But the big difference there is that the concept and idea of the Bride is something that has lasted before the actress that has played her, and will last probably much longer than the actress that currently plays her. If not, sometimes those characters die with the legacy of that actor that plays them. And, you know, they have ownership over those characters to a certain extent, but not nearly as much ownership as the actors do over their characters at Fright Fest. You know, it's this sense of ownership and pride that really drives a lot of it. And I think you and I know a lot of these people firsthand, you know, and we know some actors too who work at Scary Farm as well. And I'm not doubting their pride in what they're doing there. You know, I'm not taking
away absolutely not. No, absolutely not. No,
this is just something very unique and different.
That has it's on a different level.
Feel. It's different. It's so completely different.
It's because the park gives them and allows them to have that freedom.
Yeah, there's a working together with the park.
It's like a symbiotic to a character.
Yeah.
It's a symbiotic allow
these
thing.
Actors to come up with fun stuff
yeah.
to add to their character as long as it doesn't cross any lines.
Right.
Sure, why not? Let's add it to the character. How's it going to play into the story of them? How does it work in the scare zone? You know, they work together, which is fantastic to make something excel.
I mean, we were talking with, you know, one of the characters, they're like, oh, you know, my sister over in Kadam, you know, like they're like, it's all, you know, it's all kind of connected. Even though it's, you know, one's a scare zone and one's in a maze, but like the characters are still somehow connected in some really bizarre Fright Festy way. And, you know, it's just
Fright Festy way.
I don't know. hey, come on. It's like almost 10 o'clock.
No. The funny thing is that I'm picking up what you're putting down. I just find that a very funny an apt description, and I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah. It's just, and again, it's not to say that this is, you know, that over here it's, you know, necessarily, you know, not as good, or it's not that at all. It's just a different type of thing. So where, you know, at Knott's or Universal, like they have their things that they do better than anybody else. At Fright Fest, this is what they do better than any, you know, the interaction part of their scare zone characters is what they do better than pretty much anybody else, as far as I'm concerned.
It's the Scott Ramp and the Scream team that really add a lot to it. You know, the prosthetics and the makeup are absolutely stunning mixed with those character interactions. It just takes everything to the next level.
And then you throw in the lighting and just, you know, it's, yeah, it they just do, you know, it's a different thing. I mean, think of, you know, they've kind of started doing this a little bit at Knott's with the Goring 20s. And just think of like that kind of concept, but in all of their scare zones where they have stories and they're doing these different things throughout the night. And you know, things like that. So it's kind of, you know, Fright Fest alive, so to speak.
it's so funny that I that you even bring that up, because somebody asked me to describe Delusion, and I did describe Delusion as a haunted house version of Ghost Town Alive, which is exactly what it is.
Yeah.
But you're right. It does kind of feel like that. It feels like a Ghost Town Alive version of a scare zone for Fright Fest, which I absolutely love. And I think one of their newest additions, I think it kind of takes that to the next level, and that is Devil's Triangle. Now, the Devil's Triangle is the new scare zone for the entrance of the park, replacing the I think it was Devil's Door, which was like
Demon's Door,
which was clearly demons roaming around and, you know, trying to get you. And that was a very bombastic, high energy entry scare zone. And the Devil's Triangle is a little bit more moody, a little bit more totally focused rather than just being loud and scary, which I think works on certain levels. Do I think it's a little odd to have something so mellow at the entrance of the park? Maybe. But what they lack in maybe energy of that sort, they make up for in the story of those interactions, because they have a show that happens nightly called The Rising, which basically gives you an insight on the reason why these people are the way that they are. And if you wander around that scare zone long enough, they're going to start talking to you and give you pieces of stories like, hey, don't talk to those people. Watch out for those witches. You know, look at my face is how I became this way. You know, they're going to give you all those bits and pieces. So when you get to see the show, all those pieces are like little puzzle pieces fitting together. That's going to give you more in-depth understanding of why the scare zone is the scare zone. And I love it. That's something new that Fright Fest has never really done before.
Yeah.
And delve into the story of the scare zone. I mean, scare zones can be scare zones, and that's fine. But to have that information is pretty cool.
It is. And, you know, and I think the more mellow scare zone works for an event like Fright Fest, because as we've mentioned, you know, they don't close the park. So a lot of times you're not in that front scare zone until you're leaving the park. So by that time, you're probably ready for kind of more of a mellow kind of, you know, interactive scare zone type area versus kind of a high energy of, you know, something, you know, some other place. You know, like at Universal, you've got the, you know, the flames and it's all higher energy all night.
Yeah.
You've got the heavy metal music as you, you know, and everyone's coming in that way. But at Fright Fest, you know, if you're starting at, you know, where Unleashed is, that's the very back of the park. And by the time you get to Devil's Triangle, you know, it's, you know, you've probably done everything else and you're, now he's like, okay, I'm going to chill and kind of get into the characters and interact with these people and see the show and, you know, this and that. So I think, again, more than any other park, I think it kind of works better at Magic Mountain than it would work somewhere else.
I do agree. I think the only other place, especially because this one, it's more of like a nautical theme, is, you know, it actually really reminded me of Dark Harbor.
A little
like
bit.
A ton.
And they used the fountain during the show. They used it very, very well, as far as the lighting in the front fountain, the iconic fountain at Magic Mountain. They used that very well with the scare zone, which I thought was really a nice touch.
Yeah, and with the show, you know, if you're listening to this and you're like, do I need to see that to understand it? No, you don't have to. If you want to catch it and see it, it's cool, but it's not necessary to understanding the concept of what's happening in the scare zone. Like, you could easily walk through, talk to a couple monsters, and kind of get the gist of what's happening if you ask the right questions.
And I think they do the show a couple times a night. It was like 11 minutes long. It didn't need to be that long to be. I mean, if I'm being completely
half the length would have been perfect.
Five 6 minutes, I think would have been just fine. I'm imagining they'll probably tweak it at some point. But you know, it's still fun. To kind of go through the story. But yeah, it seemed to repeat itself a couple times. I would have rather had an extra 5 minutes of interacting with the characters versus them being up on the stage when we were over there. But I mean, it's a cool thing, you know, to kind of have a scare zone and then, you know, well, we're going to do a show right in the middle of the scare zone. You know, that's kind of cool. That's kind of an interesting. And again, you can start seeing, you know, some other, you know, events that are starting to kind of move in that direction as well. Kind of, you know, blurring the lines between show and scare zone type thing, and I think that's a cool thing. I'm all for it. I'm definitely excited to see where kind of that concept goes in future years.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. I'd love to see future scare zones even adapt something similar, maybe not as formal as having a stage, but you know, maybe show moments every hour of sorts rather than a full blown production of sorts. So, moving on to the next one, which is actually right down the way, and this is Carn of Hell, which is one of the other new scare zones for this year. Step right up and enter, if you dare, into this once thrilling circus that's been taken over by a carnivorous band of carnies. Now, it's kind of carnies mixed with animal-human hybrids and lots of stuff. Now, although it may not be a super accurate description of what it is, this is probably one of my most... the highest scares out of my list in terms of what we experienced, because there were so many freaking monsters.
There were so many. Yeah. And you know, if you know Magic Mountain, this is basically in Bugs Bunny World. So you kind of, as you're walking from, you know, the front area of the park towards, you know, DC Universe and City Under Siege, you kind of have to make it right. I'll be honest, like, it didn't seem like a whole lot of people knew that it was there. And I did reach out to the park, and they were kind of already aware that, you know, they needed some signage and stuff like that to get people over there. But yeah, there was just, there's so many characters in there, very interactive. I've even, you know, gotten a couple reached out to me, you know, afterwards and, hey, was that you in Carn of Hell the other night? And, you know, pictures and, you know, so I sent them some pictures that they could put up on their Instagram pages and stuff like that. So just a really, really fun, scare zone. Again, it's you know, the interaction there is great, and then obviously Bugs Bunny World is a very, you know, kind of enclosed area. It's very, you know, small, but then you've got the trees kind of overhanging, and they've got the lights up in the trees, and they've got some cauldrons there, and just, you know, the fog and some hay bales, and it's just a really really, really fun little area, and I'm glad that they did something over here finally.
Honestly, like, two things with the scare zone. One, I feel like because there was such a variety in monsters that the scare tactics varied a lot. You don't know if you're going to have a monster come up to you to scare you or say something ridiculous and crazy,
right,
or make a joke at your expense,
or
and
both.
It kind of, or both, and it really keeps you on your toes.
Yeah.
There was like a gypsy woman that was absolutely terrifying to look at, but on the flip side, there was a chef that was like a boar whose apron said, like, kiss the chef.
Yeah.
You know, or and, like and a woman cat of sorts meowing at people.
Yeah.
Lots of stuff. And I absolutely loved the variety. It was fantastic.
And there was like one guy that's like, oh, come over here and look at what I found. Look what I found. And then you get, he goes around the corner and he comes back and just like, you know, right in your face. And it was like, that's really cool. Just, you know, you move from like this, you know, interaction of like, hey, look what I found. I'm a crazy, you know, circus person. And then like it comes around and like, you know, now you're getting scared. It's a nice combo type thing.
And the other thought that comes to mind is, why on earth is it in Bugs Bunny World? That makes absolutely no sense. There's nothing in Bugs Bunny World that's Fright Fest related. Why is it not on a major thoroughfare? If anything, why is this not where it's carnival themed already past DC Universe?
Yeah, I mean, that would make a little bit more sense. I'll be honest with you. But I kind of do like the kind of the creepiness kind of under the trees, you know, in Bugs Bunny World. It does feel very closed in. And there's a couple of scare zones at Magic Mountain. I know we're going to get into the other ones, but there's a couple of scare zones at Magic Mountain that kind of use the trees to their advantage. And I'm actually, I'm okay with where it is, just because I like that kind of closed in. It kind of reminds me of the Hollow a little bit. I do wish that they would move it. You know, use Bugs Bunny World and the walkway that it goes from, you know, Full Throttle to Goliath. I wish they would kind of expand it and use both. Make it bigger, because there's, you know, there's a big gap there. Between, you know, where Full Throttle is all the way to, you know, DC Universe, where there's nothing other than the little Bugs Bunny World thing. You know, there's just a dead spot.
There's a lot of trees right there, too. So, like, what say, like, you take out every single prop that they had in there that was specifically for Carn of Hell, put it in the middle of the walkway, or maybe jutting out from one side of the walkway. So,
yeah.
Guests have to walk around them,
right.
Which gives, like, this natural opportunity to scare the living crap out of people. And I think that would work really well, because right now, unfortunately, they're just kind of wandering in the
middle of the pathway. They're off to the side. Yeah. And there's a couple of scares with that Magic Mountain kind of suffer from, they need to be more front and center than they are. So,
I mean, we could talk about the other one right now, and that's the Dead Zone. Dead Zone is essentially a glorified gauntlet, which we have talked many a times together about how we didn't really like how Horror Nights does gauntlets to a certain extent. And they're doing it here. And I feel like the concept of the Dead Zone is cool enough. It and works well with the area of West Coast Racers.
It's just off to the side.
To establish it as a full zone, scare zone, instead of just being put off to the side.
Yeah,
what if you put that chain link fence in the middle of the road so that it made it feel like it was a little bit more of a scare zone rather than just...
There's a sign in the middle of the road, but that's pretty much about it. Yeah, it's, you know, and again, we kind of talked about the Dead Zone earlier when we were talking about Aftermath, but yeah, it's just kind of off the side. You could walk by it and not even know it's there if you're not really looking for it. And I just think that, you know, if they're going to use a gauntlet, that's great. Put it in the middle. There's plenty of room back in that area. That where if people don't want to go through it, they can go, you know, they can go around to where the gauntlet is right now or where the Dead Zone is right now and kind of go around it. There's a big enough walkway there where they could have definitely put it more front and center in that area.
There's so many opportunities for different things in that area, especially because at that far back end, if you're not going to turn right to go to Aftermath and you go up the hill, you can have sliders over there. Like, have, like, a slider prepped and ready on the hill waiting for people to come towards it. Run slides all the way down the hill towards them.
Yeah.
But you have these monsters kind of dedicated to this one footprint. Yeah, sometimes they come out and loop around to the back and scare people walking by. I saw one even venture out as far as that quick service restaurant near the bottom of the hill. But that's about it. Like, they need to be able to have free reign over that entire area.
Yep.
That's one of my biggest gripes when it comes to Horror Nights, is that scare zones are very, very confined. And I hate when that happens because it's called a scare zone, not a scare spot. So let's let them have fun and give them the entire area to play with. Because it's going to give the event a bigger, more cohesive feel when you have those opportunities to expand upon what you've already done right. Which, the Dead Zone is a cool zone. Visually, it's really fun to look at.
Yeah.
Expand. Let them have fun. You know, well, I think it's a perfect opportunity.
One thing I will say in Horror Nights defense, they just don't have a whole lot of room for scare zones, at least they in Hollywood. They don't,
but I mean, we're going to get in a whole tangent if I start this.
I know.
Like, the issue that I have is that I feel like when it comes to Horror Nights, the only two scare zones that you really are forced to walk through is the entry one and the New York Street one. The one that's coming out of the exit, whatever house is in Parisian Courtyard, is inevitably going to be one that you aren't really going to make sure you go over to check out unless you're leaving the haunted house.
Right.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
You have Terror Tunnel or Toxic Tunnel, you know, if they have that, which they don't have that going on right now. So outside of the scare zones up top, there's no other scare zones.
Yeah. And you can
easily avoid them.
And they
I don't want scare zones to be avoidable.
No, I'm with you. And you know, they've tried doing them on the lower lot, and I think it's just too cramped down there right now. But again, going back to Magic Mountain, obviously, which we're talking about, Magic Mountain has the room to have scare zones everywhere. They have the gift of space, and they're not, for a couple of scare zones, they're just not using it right now.
Side tangent, and I want to pose a question to you. How would you feel if Fright Fest focused more on scare zone and shows and maybe one haunted house instead of focusing on all the haunted houses and then the scare zones as well? Because if they work on something that they excel at, why not put all the effort into it?
I'd actually be okay with it.
It's not a typical haunt in the sense of like, come here and go on all the haunted houses.
Right.
Come here, ride coasters at night, and have fun surviving getting from one to the other.
Yeah.
Because there's nowhere to
escape. I think I'd actually be okay with that, to be honest with you. I think
like imagine that experience. Like, you go from one coaster to another, and there's literally nowhere to go.
Yeah. And that was kind of the concept that Magic Mountain was going for not even 5 years ago, where there were scare zones pretty much in the entire park.
And roaming hordes.
And I don't know why they kind of moved away from that. But no, if you were going to take all of the, you know, let's say you're going to have, you know, Willoughby's, or you're going to have, you know, maybe one huge maze like where Aftermath is. And it's just, you know, all these, maybe it's like a kind of like a Reign of Terror thing where like each area is like a different theme or something. Like it's maybe a 20-minute maze, and then the rest is just going to be scare zone. I'm actually okay with it.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, use Aftermath just simply because it's a people eater and it's huge. But you could easily say, like, here are three themes.
Yeah.
The first, like, 10 minutes of this experience is that theme, and then you all lead into the same exit at the same time. But you could easily have three fun different themes, and it could all tie into what you have at the park. So whether that be Devil's Triangle, Card of Hell, and then Exile Hill all being a part of that maze. But I don't know. It's an interesting concept and an idea just to kind of play around with in your head, just because this is what they do best.
It is.
They show it very easily.
It is. Maybe we should buy Fright Fest and we'll do it next year.
I've wanted to just work for Fright Fest just so that I could implement ideas that I think would work for the park and just take them to the next level. Oh my god, dude! So many times.
Let's do it.
I want you so bad. Hire us. I'll work for cheap. Anyway, moving on. Let's talk about Exile Hill. Now, Exile Hill is the, I would say, probably one of two of the most favorite, or rather, famous scare zones from this event. The dead have risen and are looking for the new souls to take on this dark and sinister hill, which is basically over by Willoughby's, because it's the same characters. And it's a classic. You can't really beat it. It's moody. It's creepy. It's fantastic.
I mean, obviously, the highlight of the scare zone is that's where you can see Innocence.
Yeah. It's so funny watching people interact with her, dude.
Oh yeah.
It's always so funny watching
people. And she's not moving.
She's not moving.
No, and she's so good. Like, if there were like scare actor awards for like just staying in character no matter what or whatever, it would be her.
I would easily give it to her.
Yeah.
It's so funny because you watch people's reactions evolve very quickly.
Yeah, yeah.
From, oh, this is stupid, she's not moving, she's not scary, to, oh, she's moving a little bit. That's a little weird. I'm not a huge fan of that, but I mean, it's not scary still. To when she starts getting on the ground, she's on the ground now, growling towards me. I really don't like this. I don't want her coming near me. I need to leave right now. To complete fear, when she's like right by you and she jolts forward just a little bit, not even a lot. She doesn't even do like a big jump scare or anything. It's just enough for you to pee your pants.
Yeah, and 100%.
The biggest guys are just like crumble.
Yeah, it's great.
Hysterical.
And I think that. I mean, I've talked to, you know, we both know scare actors from other events, and to a person, you know, when you start talking about innocence, they're like, yeah, that she's just the best. Like, it's just, there's just no, I don't think any person who's a scare actor at any other event or even Fright Fest who's had interactions with her in character would dispute that. She's like, you know, she's like the Serena Williams of like scare actors, you know?
Yeah, you're right. You're definitely right. So yeah, Exile Hill, it's just a classic. So make sure you head on up there and check it out. It's foggy, it's dark, it's creepy, it's scary. I love it so very much. It just needs more people. I think when we were there, there's only a few monsters.
Yeah, I agree.
Huge sense of trend, people. Huge sense of trend. So a lot of these scare zones need more people. The houses need more people. But it is what it is. Moving on, let's talk about City Under Siege. This is the famous clown scare zone. The clowns are loose again and running rampant through the streets. Beware what lurks in the shadows. Now, City Under Siege was like one of my favorites in past years. High energy, bombastic, crazy, ridiculous, funny. They had a great slider show. And now it's very quiet, open, and kind of barren.
Yeah, it's... I want to say that I think this is a scare zone in transition. I have every hope, and I really do hope that it's just because things were so delayed in DC Universe, they didn't have a whole lot of time to deal with how they're going to reimagine City Under Siege for the new DC Universe. I mean, like I said, it's much more open. You know, the Flash is gone. You know, so I'm really just hoping that it's just, you know, they had to work so hard on getting DC Universe up and running. I mean, the store just opened very recently. The other facades near the roundup are not even done yet. So the area is not even done yet. So I'm really just hoping that that's just a cause of the delays in the area. And it's not how it's going to be every year. So I'm really just crossing my fingers that City Under Siege comes back roaring strong next year. Because, you know, there was the lasers and there was the lights and the canopy music. And the music. And like I said, the slider show and the clowns and everything. And it could just be false hope. I hope it's not.
I'm in agreement with you. I think that it's a transitionary phase. You have Wonder Woman built in there, new DC Universe stuff, a much bigger plot of land. It's hard to adjust the scare zone for that when you're so used to it being so narrow, compact, with all those little flat rides all around. So changing for this, going to take some time, and I'm totally fine with that.
Yeah.
You know, it is disappointing. It was disappointing, you know, walking in, seeing a scare zone that I absolutely loved, just kind of very open and unpopulated. Yeah. Some of the scare actors there were absolutely fantastic.
Oh yeah,
in fact, great. One of the scare actors that I got a video of now had the video on TikTok has 250,000 views.
Oh nice!
Like people think it's funny. People think it's great.
Yeah,
you know, so that's testament to what they're doing. I just think it's kind of setting people up for failure because you know there's only so much you can do in that zone.
Yeah,
you don't have as much as you used to work with.
Yeah, so. And they lost a couple of veteran clowns in here this year too. We talked about the characters at Fright Fest, and when you lose two iconic characters at Fright Fest, you're gonna probably feel it a little bit. So again, I have every confidence that next year, City Under Siege will be back and as good as ever. Just crossing my fingers.
Agreed. And so the next one, which isn't too far away, which is off to the right-hand side, is Territory Twisted. The steam-spewing mechanical beasts relentlessly hunt down their victims. We didn't even go over there.
No, we didn't.
I don't think I knew that Territory Twisted was back, to be fairly honest.
I kind of saw it, and I didn't want to say anything. I was like, I've never been a huge fan of it, to be honest with you. It's never really been one of my favorites. I think the props in there are great. I think the lighting in there is fantastic. It's just, it's always just been kind of
for me. It is very, it doesn't feel alive. It feels very barren. It feels very boring. You know, I think last year I said something very, very similar. Like, if it weren't for the projections of the gears on the walls,
yeah,
I probably would be very, like, it wouldn't have any sense of life to it. Which is funny, because we're talking about undead beings, right. But, like, still,
yeah,
you know, like, it doesn't have that much life to it. And I think that this zone needs some adjustments, and even if that just means sound design and lighting to get people's attention over there, because I didn't even know.
Yeah,
I didn't even know it was over there. Just by, and I was staring at it for the longest time.
Right. Yeah. I would honestly like rather than like move that stuff like that dead zone that we've been talking about between Full Throttle and Goliath, like move it over there. Like it doesn't have to be steampunk. It could be, you know, they can use some of those props for different things and
just kind of use vampires. That
or, yeah, or something. Yeah. It just it's off in a corner. Yes, Twisted Colossus is over there, which is obviously amazing, and Scream is over there, but it's not the area doesn't fit a scare zone. There's just not enough.
Not at all.
It's the way that it's on a weird curve, and then there's the sign there. It's just, and then there's the theater there that sometimes they have a show in and sometimes they don't. It doesn't feel like an area that should be a scare zone when you have so many other areas of the park that don't have a scare zone that should have a scare zone.
And I mean, like I've said it with other things, it's like put the scare zones in a pathway that's highly populated.
Right
now you have a scare zone that's there only for people who are willing to go to
Twisted rides. Colossus and Scream.
Twisted Colossus and Scream, and that's it.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you could say the same thing with City Under Siege, but at least those clowns come all the way out of that scare zone to the main pathway.
Well, not just that, but
all the way out.
Not just that, but if you're walking, you know, that direction, you're passing Goliath and going under Superman, you can see all the way into DC Universe. Like, if you want to go, you still have to, for Territory Twisted, you still have to make that right turn. And even after you make that right turn, you still have to go kind of past the sign before you start seeing anything. It's, you know, at least DC Universe, it's open and you're drawn to it from the sign and, you know, everything. Yeah. You're just not drawn to anything over there, to be honest with you.
And if we're gonna stay on the topic of scare zones that feel like they're in an odd place, let's talk about terrorizing dark developments. Now this is beware the dark developments that could haunt you for all eternity as your worst nightmares rise up from the depths of hell and prey on the innocent who dare to enter this abandoned cemetery. Now this is that pathway leading up from Revolution to Viper, and it only had two monsters in it, which is an issue upon itself. They both were killing it, by the way.
Yeah. Like,
they were working their butts off and doing a great job, but it's such a weird spot for a scare zone.
Very.
I feel like this, because it's so, it's a very simple concept that can be placed anywhere. And why here? Because literally that pathway is just never highly populated.
Absolutely not. People avoid that hill because you can. You can take the, you know, the whatever the...
You almost called it the Oriental Express.
Yeah, the Orient Express or the Helpful Honda, whatever it's called now.
Helpful Honda Magical...
Magic Express Mountain, or whatever. Yeah.
Gateway, whatever it's called. Tracky ride thingy bobber.
Yeah. So, you know... It's not a fun hill to walk up. The only thing I would say that, you know, if you're going to use this, then you need to have sliders that are like sliding down the entire hill. But yeah, again, you got dead zones. We've already talked about a couple of dead zones in the park. I'm not going to mention them again. But yeah, I think it would be a much better fit elsewhere. Because again, the lighting is fantastic. Sound design is great. Like you said, the characters that were there are working really hard and they're trying.
I mean, it just feels like wasted talent because they are good.
Yeah, it's just
you're giving them nobody to deal with.
Yeah, it's a bad location. You know, it is technically on a quote unquote main path of the park, But it is not one of the heavily traversed paths, especially during Fright Fest. You know, during normal park hours, you know, there's a rush there every morning for people trying to go on X2 or up to Tatsu. But during Fright Fest, it's not a very heavily traveled path versus some of the other ones that we've talked about.
I mean, imagine putting all the lights that are shot up on the live sign. Imagine that all being red, and you have like these structures of mausoleums scattered throughout the walkway, and you could have that be the zone. Like, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, that would be amazing. Yeah, no. And you've got that nice big courtyard in front of Goliath where you could have your sliders in there. And I think it would work infinitely better there than it does where it's at right now.
And let's talk about the last scare zone of Fright Fest. And this is home to one of our favorite characters at Fright Fest. This is Nightmares of Twisted Fantasy. This evil nightmare has never been so edgy as your favorite bedtime stories take on a new and twisted tale. Now, this is a blacklight scare zone with, you know, as it says, very much evil versions of bedtime stories like Pinocchio or the Queen of Hearts and just all these different kind of like weird whimsical creatures. And it's so freaking good. It is so good.
Yeah.
They added dialogue to the environment this year that kind of gives it more of a story.
Like a voiceover, yeah.
It fleshes it out a bit more. The lighting is fantastic, and because Red's Revenge is gone, it got an upgrade in terms of like decorations.
Yeah,
like
some new props.
Lots of stuff from Red's came over.
Which is great. I got no problem with that. And you know, this is not only my favorite scare zone at Fright Fest, this is one of my favorite scare zones at any event. It's just, you know, it's creepy. It uses the environment so well with the trees overhanging, so they don't have to put anything else in there to make it a black light, you know, other than the black lights and the, you know, the different paint effects and things. They don't have to block anything out because it's so kind of closed in there already. And then the fog kind of lingers in there because of the trees. And then, you know, but then, you know, again, to go back, you know, what makes Fright Fest Fright Fest? You know, the characters in here. You have your classic characters that have been there for years that we've been interacting with. You know, we've got, you know, Lorraine. We've had videos with Lorraine since probably 2016 now. Every year, it's a continuing story. You know, and then some of the other characters in that scare zone now are getting just as iconic and, you know, expanded stories as hers is. She's bringing in like her little family, and you know, and we know the actress, you know, outside of Fright Fest, and you know, that it's no surprise that she's bringing younger actors and younger scare actors into that zone and kind of taking them, so to speak, under her wing, maybe on her flying monkey's wings or something, and just kind of mentoring them. And it's just, it's kind of amazing to see, to be honest with you. You know, when we went in there, you know, she was, you know, flying away somewhere and wasn't there for a bit. And it, we just had such a great time with all the other characters in there until, you know, obviously we were waiting to see her as well. And, not to sound like a broken record, but this is what makes Fright Fest Fright Fest. This is what makes it unique. This is what I go for. You know, it's not the mazes, it's not the rides. I've ridden the rides at Magic Mountain, you know, umpteen million times, even though we did ride quite a few rides when we went.
We did. It was a bunch of fun.
It was fun. But this, you know, areas like this are why I go to Fright Fest every year, and why I still, despite the nitpicky things that we've talked about for the last hour and a half, why I still recommend people go to Fright Fest because of things like nightmares.
And the thing is, when you have people going to Fright Fest and specifically going to an area to meet a very specific character, you know you're doing something right.
Yep.
When these people want so very badly to experience one of the scare zones just to have their own unique experience with a very specific character. And that's awesome. You know, we're not the only ones that feel that way about those characters in that scare zone.
Right.
There's so many people that want to have that interaction with Lorraine and Lorraine.
It's like hear about Mickey the Mouse.
Chocolate pumpkin lattes.
That's
like a very deranged, crazy version of Mickey Mouse. But yes.
Right.
fire and ice facials that she's seeing this year, or the pedicures of the severed foot that she holds. You know, it's all this really elaborate story that everyone is involved in, and it's so much fun. And as Gregg said, we know this actress who plays Lorraine. Funny enough, she also plays Mrs. Claus at Holiday in the Park, which here's my official open letter to have her play Mrs. Claus again, because she's the best Mrs. Claus there is.
100%.
You know, my daughter met her as Mrs. Claus, and my daughter was in love. Like, this is my kid is like, she gets it when people are not on her level and when they are. You know, she can sense their vibes really quickly. And my daughter was like, head over heels, I want to sit on this woman's lap. I want to talk to her. I'm going to tell her my name. I'm going to tell her what it's like. Hey, hold up. Santa's over here. You need to sit on his lap and tell him what you want. But man, she definitely needs to get that Mrs. Claus spot again, because it would be a travesty if she didn't get it. But, you know, we're talking about Fright Fest, and, you know, I'm just thankful that we have her as Lorraine in the scare zone, because she really makes the event for me. Like, it is a unbelievable, huge highlight every single year.
Every year, yeah. 100% with you.
So, I think it's very obvious that, you know, we love Nightmares. Nightmares is, like, the best scare zone at Fright Fest, in my opinion. Yeah, it's a little bit out of the way, but I think it's the only area of the park, other than maybe that area in front of Bugs Bunny World, that would make sense in terms of its whimsical nature and what it needs, and the trees really help.
Yeah. You need that kind of enclosed area that only really, like you said, only really that area and maybe one or two others could facilitate at that part, because there's no stores in, you know, there's no like restaurants, or there's no, you know, stores in that area. There's no, you know, games, there's no rides other than Revolution kind of flying over your head every couple minutes. There's no like ODV cards. There's nothing else there other than just that scare zone. And you need it to be in its own little pod, so to speak, for it to actually work. It doesn't work. It wouldn't work in many other parks, let alone anywhere else really in that park either.
I mean, I'd love to see it expand.
Don't get me wrong.
Love to see it expand.
Yeah.
I mean, it always feels popular because it's such a compact space, but because it's so good, I want to see it expand. You know, add some more creatures, add some more stories.
Yeah.
You know, add some character beat moments like you did with the entry scare zone. You know, expand upon it, build upon it, and reinforce the scare zones that are the best at your event.
I mean, technically, they could do it like on the other side of, you know, Katie's Kettle and Roaring Rapids, kind of, you know, use both sides of the hill. You know, they could do that at some point. I think that would work.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to that at all. But yeah, no, that kind of brings us to the end of our conversation about Six Flags. You know, talking about the scare zones, we talked about Spirit with Spirits, we talked about the new haunted houses and things. You know, this year seems like a very odd transitionary period. You know, it seems like it's kind of a mixed bag of things. Overall, at the end of the day, did we leave with a smile on our face? Yeah, we did. But did we have fun? 100%. Are there things we would want to change? Clearly. But at the end of the day, it really just matters that if you have fun. And I did. And I'd go back in a heartbeat and enjoy it all over again.
Yeah, I'm with you. You know, and again, I think that Fright Fest isn't the only event this year that seems kind of to be having a kind of an off thing, and I know that you know, I don't want to get off on that, but it's like you said, it's, we still had fun, we had a blast, you know, we had a fun night, and I'll probably, you know, try and get back at least once more. I do want to go through the new maze, even though, you know, I hate to judge things just based on video, which we kind of did, but you know,
I mean, it's very clear what was in that maze.
It wasn't like you know, it. In this case, I'm okay with it.
There's not much room for interpretation.
No, there's not. So. No, I'm with you, and that's the only reason why I decided that we can base that off the video. But I do want to go back and experience it, because there's one thing watching it on video, and there's another, you know, experiencing it in person. You know, that was the first night that it was open. You know, not to, you know, excuses, but, you know, I do like to experience things on my own. But no, we had a great time. Fright Fest, you know, as we've talked about the last hour and a half, you know, Fright Fest has their things that they do very well. And Fright Fest has the things that we would like to improve. And, you know, but we had fun. And again, I think with Magic Mountain, it's somewhat unique where, you know, if you have a Six Flags pass, you really don't have to pay money to go to Fright Fest. You can go and experience the scare zones and the shows and have a great night without doing the mazes. And even if you do want to do the mazes, it's like $20. So,
exactly.
You know, it's exactly. It's not one of these nights that's going to cost you, you know, $400 for, you know, admission and, you know, front of the line passes and, you know, all this stuff. It's going to, you know, it's a value night, but it's a fun night, and that's okay.
Thank you, Gregg, so much for joining me in our conversation about Fright Fest at Six Flags Magic Mountain.
My pleasure. I was glad that you asked me to do this.
So, dude, shout out your website, everything, where people can find you, all of it. Let people know.
You can find me at parkjourney.com, Twitter and Instagram at park_journey, Facebook and YouTube. Just search for Park Journey, TikTok, Theme Park Duo, because I don't have one.
Yes, that would be me. Thank you very, very much for that. But yes, thank you, Gregg, for joining us on this week's episode. Thank you for taking the seat of Nikki's co-host job for this episode, because she didn't attend with us, so it was up to us to do the good deed and do the review on the podcast together. Since we seem to be going to a lot of events this year together, we're kind of inseparable almost.
I know, right?
Yeah. So thank you again. No, I have a blast. I mean, I it's always fun to have a hot boyfriend, as it were.
Shh, we were going to talk about that on the show.
Sorry, it's private. We haven't put that out into the world quite yet. But anyway, thank you everybody for listening to this week's episode. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Hopefully you got some insight onto this year's Fright Fest at Six Flags Magic Mountain. If you guys love what we're doing here, you want to support the show, and a free way to support the show, head on over to iTunes and leave us a 5-star written review. It raises us up higher in the standings. It makes it easier for everyone to find us and enjoy us, like you guys are right now. There's also places where you can support us monetarily if you want to. We have t-shirts and all those sorts of fun stuff. It's the Theme Park Duo on them. There's other silly, ridiculous nonsense on t-shirts on our Tee Public page. That link is also in the description of this episode. It is on every other episode, pretty much. And if you guys want to support the sponsor of Theme Park Duo, that is DRNXMYTH. If you want freshly made cocktails delivered directly to your door, check out the Buy Drinks link in the show description. If you want to follow us on social media, you can always follow us at Theme Park Duo on all social media platforms. That is Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, TikTok, everything. You can find us at Theme Park Duo. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, things you want to hear, things you don't want to hear, things you're annoyed about, telling Gregg that you want him to grow his hair back, you can always reach out to us at themeparkduo@gmail.com. Now, thank you again, everybody, for tuning into this week's episode. And always remember, there's always a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. See ya.
Thanks for riding with the Theme Park Duo. Make sure to gather all your belongings before the end of the podcast. Bye-bye.